Some academics, other than creationists, and some science journals have come out recently in the last year or the last few months even, with titles like Darwin Was Wrong on the cover of The New Scientist, or Why Darwin Was Wrong in Jerry Fodor's new book. What's your attitude to titles and texts and claims like these?
They're dishonest. I mean, in the case of the New Scientist, that was a shameless bid for increasing circulation, which it did.
Yeah.
If you actually read the article, it was nothing to do with Darwin Was Wrong.
No.
What it was about was pointing out, which is true, that in bacteria, the tree of life is no longer a simply branching tree. Now, once you get it into larger animals, so-called eukaryotes, animals and plants, the tree of life is pretty much entirely strictly a branching tree. Once a species has split, which they do all the time, that's the origin of species, once they've split, there's a certain short period of time during which it's still possible for gene flow to occur. They can still possibly mate with each other. Once they've split further apart than that, then there's no longer any gene flow. They can't mate together. They're apart forever. There's never any gene exchange between them, unless it's engineered by humans or some very, very special process. But in bacteria, and Darwin was of that view, in bacteria, that doesn't happen. In bacteria, there's a constant promiscuous exchange of genetic information. It's rather more like computer programs where you can copy and paste. You copy a fragment of a program, paste it into another one. So bacteria work by copy and paste, rather than by sex as we do. And the copy and paste can go between very unrelated strains of bacteria. So in bacteria, the tree of life is no longer a strictly branching hierarchy. It's more of a kind of crisscrossing anastomosis. So that's an interesting enough point to make. But to give it the headline, Darwin Was Wrong.
Yes. You were famous in the first instance for your book, The Selfish Gene. You said later that you could have called it The Cooperative Gene.
Yes.
Without a word being changed. I'm not quite sure that I would think that is the case if you went through word by word, but never mind. You also strongly oppose multi-level selection, which nevertheless seems to be gaining some ground amongst serious biologists.
Well, let me deal with the first point
first. Okay.
The selfish gene is a way of explaining the cooperative individual.
Yes.
And that's what I suppose much of the book is about, and it's been much misunderstood by people who've read the book by title only,
sure.
Without reading the, as I've put it before, the rather long footnote to the title, which is the book itself. So it's about cooperative individuals, and selfish genes lead to cooperative individuals. But there's also a sense in which genes do cooperate, because genes are selected, again, for their own benefit, their own selfish benefit, but against the background of the other genes that they're likely to meet. And by meet, I mean meet within the same individual. Because of sexual reproduction, the genes in a gene pool, which is the collection of genes in the whole of a species, or the whole of a breeding population anyway, the genes in a gene pool are constantly meeting each other in different individuals. And so they have to cooperate. If they didn't cooperate, the individual that they're in wouldn't survive. And so you and I, or an elephant, or a hippo, or a mouse, is the product of a highly cooperative genetic enterprise. Now, it isn't that genes are selected as cooperative units. That's not quite the way it works. Each separate gene is selected for its capacity to thrive in the presence of the other genes that it's likely to meet, which means it's going to have cooperative characteristics. So that's the sense in which the gene could have been called the cooperative gene. Now, you talked about multi-level selection, which is another matter entirely. The only kind of selection that really matters is gene selection. Gene selection, meaning the differential survival of genes in gene pools, changing gene frequencies, selectively successful genes become more numerous in the gene pool, and unsuccessful ones become less numerous in the gene pool. The reason why successful ones become more numerous, the reason why they're successful, is that they're good at programming the world, which usually means the embryonic development of individuals. Almost everything a gene does is to program the embryonic development of an individual in such a way that the individual is good at surviving, good at reproducing, good at passing on the same genes. Now, there are tweaks to that idea. There are important respects in which individuals may look after the interests of other individuals, especially if they're close kin, because they have a high probability of containing the same genes. And this all was all, I described all this in the selfish gene as well. Some people like to call that multi-level selection. I prefer not to. I prefer to say that there's only really one level of selection, which is gene selection. But there may be many levels of phenotype at which the activities of the genes, at which the genes are judged, mostly the individual level, but also perhaps groups of kin, also perhaps the hive in the case of a beehive or something of that sort. I find it unhelpful to talk about group selection or species selection. Other people do like to look at it that way, as long as you remember that all the time what you're having to come back to is the calculus of gene frequency change, then you can do it. But I think it's confusing, muddling, and unhelpful to talk about multi-level selection, although some people seem to find it helpful.
Right. Okay, Richard, that's all I wanted to ask you. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much.